everyone. Thanks for joining another webinar session by Kommunicate. Really excited to have you all here. My name is Manav. I'm the host for the session today. Please drop in the chat where you all are joining us from. It's really interesting to see so many people from different parts of the world. So Kommunicate webinar series are aimed at bringing in industry thought leaders from conversational AI space to share their product building journeys and experiences. Just a quick housekeeping note, please keep your audio and video off so that we have our speaker at the center of the screen. If you have any question, please drop them at the chat session. We will take it at the end of the session. Just a brief introduction on Kommunicate. Kommunicate is a customer support automation platform which blends in AI chatbots with human touch. It's AI powered by NLP and OpenAI GPT-4 technology, offers quick, smart responses while integrated human support ensures empathy. Today, we have a very special guest with us. I'm really happy to introduce you all to Rupa Chaturvedi. Rupa is an award-winning product and UX design leader who works at the intersection of augmented reality technologies like AR, computer vision, augmented reality, VR, conversational AI, also generative AI. Rupa currently heads the merchants and ad designs at Uber. She has more than 15 years of experience in different industries like retail, e-commerce, shopping, and has helped unicorn startups like Sentient Technologies and product teams in large organizations such as Amazon and Google. During her time at Amazon, she has worked on the conversational design of Alexa. Rupa has also worked, I know, on the first chatbot that went live on Amazon mobile app. Rupa is also an adjunct lecturer at Stanford University. It's a very huge or a very long line of introduction, I know. Rupa also mentors startups and design product professionals through the Fast Track program at the First Round Capital. Please stay till the end of the session. We have a free resource on conversational AI that Rupa and her team prepared. Rupa, thank you so much for taking out the time today to share your experience on designing memorable conversational experiences that are human and effective. Even though I've introduced you, why don't you start with a short, brief description and what are you working on these days?
Sure. Hey, everyone. And thank you for having me, Manav. It's a pleasure to meet all of you. And some of you I'm meeting again. So such a nice thing to be able to run into each other again. I am currently leading a design team that focuses on solutions for merchants, restaurants, retailers on the Uber Eats marketplace, where we also support their growth, visibility, and revenue mainstream paradigms through advertising and promotions. So that's my current scope. I've recently helped launch the Uber Eats chatbot as well for consumers to be able to easily find restaurants and dish ideas as well.
That's great. Thank you so much, Rupa. I'm really sorry. I'm having a bit of network issue. I'll just change my place from the back office to the front. Okay, cool. I have a set of questions which are related to conversational AI, obviously. We'll begin with a lot. So people joining us from different parts of the world today are basically from design principals who are UI UX designers and product managers. So what are some of the core design principles that product managers and UI UX people should keep in mind while crafting conversational AI experience? What are your thoughts on it?
Yeah, sure. So I think the core principles to keep in mind, whether you're a UX UI designer who's just crafting these experiences and designing the interface, or you're a product manager trying to figure out how to shape your scope and what should be the functionality that you should offer your customers. I think some of the things to keep in mind is, number one, conversational design is very different from traditional UX design. And how does that differ? Basically, when you're designing traditional UX designs, you have a very linear approach. You're creating click-through prototypes. You're thinking of your prototypes and wireframes that just enable the user go from one point to another. And it's a very structured environment for the user. You provide them with a few affordances on the screen. They have a few choices, and they can select what they want to do. In terms of conversational AI, you're literally letting the user do whatever they feel like. They type a query based on what they want. There is no structure, and the AI has to respond to the user. So it's a very organic, non-linear, fluid journey that you have to react to rather than providing a structure that the user is constrained within. So that's one of the key principles to think about is organic, non-linear, fluid journeys for the user. Number two, I think one of the things that a lot of UX, UI designers don't get to work in their traditional environments is data. And in the case of AI design, data is as much part of the user experience as, you know, visual and, interface elements are. And so where is your data coming from? What's the quality of the data? Is it accurate enough, right? Is it biased? You have to think about all of these aspects as a designer or a product manager, making sure that the data that you have selected will impact the user experience in a positive way, and it will not put the customer away. So they do see value in what you're bringing, and it is not negatively impacting them. And what do I mean by that? I'll give you an example. I was trying to build some content around wellness and health a couple of years ago. I started using one of the new products in the AI space, Jasper.ai, and it would constantly keep telling me that I'm not trained, till about 2019, which means the Jasper AI did not know that we all went through a global pandemic. And so when you're talking about health and wellness, that has become such a key central element of our understanding of, you know, how we want to be safe and stay healthy. And so that data that was used for training, that AI experience, did not add value to me as a user. In cases where the data has been trained on biased information that is representing a certain class of users in a negative way, or is completely ignoring them, not including them, that also creates negative experiences. And so data is a critical part of your user experience as much as any other visual element. So thinking about that is important. The third piece I would say is something that is not what we encounter in traditional UX paradigms, which is the role of persona and personality. In conversational AI, because of the way users perceive technology, especially when you tell them it is artificial intelligence, which means it needs to be smart, it needs to be able to understand some context, it cannot give me stupid, dumb answers, things like that. There's a certain set of user expectations that come with the fact that you're saying this is AI enabled, and two, you're making that interface conversational. They expect multi-turn experiences. They expect the interface to remember the context. They expect to be able to get the queries responded to the way they have written it. Now they might use the language differently. They might say the same thing in a different way than, I mean, you and I might type the same query, but in a different way, right? So the user expectations from a conversational AI experience is very different, and making sure we keep that trust and meet those expectations is important. Otherwise, we have seen people just abandon the experience. So those are three key design principles I would keep in mind to begin with.
Great. Thanks so much. That's really deep and never thought about it in that way. Like, few things are really new to me. So moving on to the next question, I know you talked about like principles, like what user considerations should we keep in mind while building this? One thing which comes to my mind is accessibility, where you need to give an option to people. Like if there's text, you also have to give them voice to text or text to voice. What other user considerations should we keep in mind when building these conversational AI applications?
Absolutely. So a couple of things. One, making sure that you're following the same accessibility guidelines that you would follow in your current product, right? So make sure you're not excluding any of those. Depending on where and how your chatbot or your conversational AI experience is structured, whether it's voice or text enabled, is it multimodal? So in the case of the Alexa projects that we did, we had two options. One is what we used to call a headless device, where there was no screen and the user was completely interacting with AI using voice. It's a very different paradigm to think about, even from an accessibility standpoint. When it comes to multimodal, which is not your computer or your phone, but it's a external device like a smart speaker, thinking about what if the user cannot see clearly, right? So then voice becomes an accessibility mechanism, for example, or enabling screen readers, things like that. if you're trying to tell the user to click one of the options on the screen, make sure they can do it by voice as well. So those are some considerations to think about, but it needs to fit with the surface that you have chosen. So in the case of maybe voice, you are enabling the user to interrupt and say, I didn't understand. Can you repeat, for example, or slow down? I need you to speak slowly or simplify. In the case of ChatGPT, I'm seeing a lot of folks saying, say, for example, write a blog article about conversational AI, and ChatGPT will write something, and then you want to change the tone or make it easier to understand, simplify the language. These are all mechanisms that you can provide the user to make the product more accessible. Again, making sure that you're following current accessibility guidelines that your product follows. So there's an extension, there's consistency, and two, being mindful of the surface the user is using your product. And voice gets a lot more complex. So making sure you're understanding the nuances of how a user processes cognitively voice interactions and from an affordance perspective as well. So those are some top of mind thoughts.
That's great. Do you think it's more harder to build voice applications than chat applications? Obviously, there's a lot of things goes out there, right?
Yes, absolutely. I think chatbots are, I wouldn't say easier or harder. I think they're just very different in nature. And so if you're choosing to go down the voice interface route, you better have a solid use case and you better have confidence that your user will be able to switch from the current mechanism. Your user is on a phone, for example, and you have an app. It's very easy for people to chat on the phone because that's a behavior they're most used to. And so from that perspective, switching from typing to voice is going to require a lot of shift in user behavior, and make sure you have a compelling reason for them to do that. Right now, the same phone application, they might be on the go, they might be running, they might be doing multitasking, they might be driving. Then voice becomes a better use case in that scenario. So again, going back to Alexa, a couple of use cases we identified was the smart speaker sitting in the middle of their kitchen, right? And people are doing multitasking, managing their life, and it becomes so easy to reach out to Alexa by voice. We also added up earphones that were Alexa enabled for people who were on the go. But if your primary use case or the primary product is on the phone and people are already chatting, then you don't want to create friction for the user and stay with chat. The reason voice is a lot more complex is because you can process a lot more information on the screen by scrolling and by trying to, pagination or things like that enable the user to take chunks of information. In voice, they have to remember what they heard, process all of that, and the attention span is much lower because there's nothing to see, there's nothing to anchor them. So it becomes a lot more complex. So when it comes to voice, you're thinking of design principles like brevity, for example. You're thinking of design principles, as I mentioned a little while ago, how do you slow the device down or how do you make them speak in a different way? These are all replicating human-to-human interaction when you use voice. So the expectation gets a lot more higher and a lot more complex for the user.
Got it. That brings to the next question is comparing between voice chat and voice UI and chat UI, even though you have already discussed it. But before we move into it, can you give our audience a little bit brief on natural user interface and graphical user interface, the differences between both of them?
Yeah, so graphical user interface would have, again, a structured layout or a structured set of visual affordances for the user to interact with. You would use some existing interaction paradigms of, if I click this button, this model will appear. Or if I click this page, here's how I go back and forth. And these are existing paradigms that every user is used to. When it comes to NLU-based experiences, you have to create a reactive experience where user would type a query. Now the AI might support or not support the query. So you need to have strong edge cases or error cases, contingencies. It is basically a chatbot based interface in most cases where the user is typing something and there is a threaded, interface for the user to manage the context and remember what did I ask and what I'm going to ask next. In that case, there are some nuances to think about. Number one, how is the user going to think about the next step? So I ask the chatbot a question, or I ask them, I give them a command, for example, what happens next? It's called multi-turn. And it's not conversational AI if it's not multi-turn, right? There's an expectation of a back and forth. So thinking of that paradigm versus how we do things in traditional UX, which is, hey, the user will hit this button or go back. They'll open this modal or close it. There's some very simpler paradigms. In conversational AI, you're thinking about first the user will do this, then they'll use this. What do you do if the user asks this? Do you know how to respond to that? Then so it's more of a flowchart approach rather than a linear approach. And then the interface is very limited, right? So a couple of things we have been doing in recent chatbots experiences, especially the one that I worked on at Uber, is you provide users with some pre-canned responses. ChatGPT does that, Google Assistant does that, a lot of new interfaces are doing that. You're providing a combination of type of freeform query, or here are some options to select from, just to make it easier for the user. So what I'm trying to say is there is a convergence happening in traditional and conversational experiences to make it easier for the user to be able to interact and reduce the friction in these new paradigms like conversational AI experiences.
Got it. Really, really engaging and exciting. So, okay, this brings to one of our second last questions, and then we'll take all the questions that's coming in the comment section. Generative AI is here. The first chatbot came in around 1960, and then Alexa, which you worked on, it came somewhere around in 2014-15, and now ChatGPT, November 2022, everything started changing. What are the major differences that you would point out between conversational AI and generative AI?
So the use cases are very different, and the way users would interact with these different AIs is different. I can explain the differences, and I'll also share with you what I'm seeing happen going forward in the next year or so. So generative AI is generally utilized for generating new content or a new material, right? You could write songs, or you could create imagery, or you could create content. And ChatGPT is a great example of that. Conversational AI is meant to replicate human-to-human conversation, and it's typically used in scenarios like Q&A, customer support, recommendations. So you're putting out a query and getting a response, and that response could be something like a summarization, a synthesis. The AI will go, scrawl a whole bunch of websites and give you a TLDR version, or they would take inputs from you and provide a personalized recommendation. In generative AI, they're not taking your inputs. They are just kind of looking at large, vast amounts of data that they've been trained in, and they're providing you with something, in many cases, a unique artifact. It could be generate a new image. It could be generate an article. It could be writing songs. I think just yesterday I saw on LinkedIn, someone posted their own generative AI bot that they had created, which just, generates music based on the lyrics you're typing. It's creating net new content, net new, I would say, IP. So those are two different scenarios. One is basically based on a use case, and two is how the user interacts with these two AIs. You'll also see a lot of convergence happening. And Notion is a great example. If you're familiar with the product Notion, it's a great example. I think ChatGPT is also at a place where you can say there is a convergence in generative AI and conversational AI. They've basically merged the two paradigms to give you the best of both worlds. And I see a lot more of that coming down in the next year or so.
Great, lovely. So any advice that you would like to give to product managers, UI, UX designers who are currently working with technologies such as generative AI and conversational AI?
Sure. I think one of the areas that most teams and most companies struggle with or end up failing is not being able to identify the right use case for AI. There's a lot of hype around AI right now. There's a lot of excitement. It's the hottest thing. A lot of companies are asking their teams, go figure out how to build an AI product. And so with that pressure, It's very easy. And I saw a question in the chat as well. I think it's from Anne. There's this concept of, let's just take an LLM API and slap a chatbot interface and quickly launch something, right? I understand that there is a lot of interest in, let's see what works. But if we don't start with a strong use case, what is the user doing today? How is AI going to add value to them over and above what they have today? So I'll give you an example. In the Uber Eats chatbot concept, we were looking at how people search for restaurants, find what they're looking for and order in the traditional UX that they have, right? And where can AI offer value more than what they are seeing today? Otherwise, no one's going to use the AI chatbot. And so thinking on those paradigms, that where is AI going to add value, incremental value over what they have today, is something to start the project with. And then you can define your interface guidelines, you can define the UX, but you start with what problem are you solving and why AI can add value to the user. I would highly recommend starting your projects with that mindset. That will set you up for success.
Cool. I think now we can take a few questions. I think you took one question from Anne already. What do you think about building bots on top of ChatGPT? There was an article about how someone tricked a car dealership bot into giving him a truck for $1. Wondering what you think about it.
Yeah, that is my biggest concern right now is because these complex technologies, these advanced level capabilities are so accessible to anyone. You can create your own version of ChatGPT. I think as with any other advanced technology, it is open to abuse, and it is open to these type of applications as well. So they're definitely concerned around that. And I think all of us have an equal responsibility to try and bring more mindful usage of technology like this. There's a lot more than just people defrauding other folks, right? There is this concept of you can hear, read articles about how China has censored a lot of content in their AI. There's no mention of political events and things like that. It's basically brainwashing people and not giving them accurate information. Or stealing people's artwork, right, without their permission. So there was another article very recently about an artist whose work has been utilized in training AI data. And now he's become very popular because of that, but he's feeling robbed of his original, IP. So we have a lot of, drawbacks with the pace of the advancement and the level of accessibility. And the more we all open up to taking responsibility towards building ethical AI experiences, the more we will be able to influence this. I think some of the regulatory developments will also help with some of these issues.
Great. When you talked about that artist whose work was getting robbed, he felt like it's getting robbed. I remembered one scenario back in the day when they were building Siri. The different voices of the different people, they did not think of that it would go so popular. The voice artists who gave their voice, they still feel that they were uncompensated for that. Okay, true. Cool. Yeah. Okay, we have this question from Jose Ramos, where he's saying, our use case is about dementia. People with aphasia, they speak unintelligibly. Can your model help us? I think he's talking about generative AI or mixed with conversational AI.
Yeah, so I would like to understand what you mean by your model, because I think you will have to train your own model in this case, and you might need to create a custom data set for this, which could potentially help in this use case. It's a very unique use case. And if you don't have data that is substantial enough to train your model and create a good user experience, you might run into some challenges where users will find it hard to use this product. And so it depends on where you can source the data, how well your model is trained, and how you articulate that into user experience. I don't know what you mean by can your model help us, but I'm assuming you will have to build your own.
Can I explain a little bit more, because you may be able to help us? So sure. You got me excited, because I think we're approaching a boundary of merging traditional conversational AI and generative AI. And this is where I think we come in with the question. Our users are people who have Alzheimer's. So when they speak with wrong words or missing words. And so they are unintelligible to their caregivers. So what they want to do though is speak. So what we're hoping is that as they speak, we can take their questions offline, translate them, and generate, this is where the generative AI part comes in, not in what they're saying, but what they intend to say. Mm-hmm. And then feed that question back into the chat box and get an answer. So you need kind of a translation in between. Yeah. And that's not only for caregivers, that would work for robots, because a robot will not understand what you're trying to tell them unless it's translated into something intelligible. So that's what we're trying to do. And I'm so happy to hear your talk, because I'm hopeful that maybe in your experiences, we can gain some advanced understanding.
Absolutely. This is such a unique use case. And thank you for sharing the context. I think let me give you an example, right? We launched Alexa in India. Now, anyone who's interacted with folks from India, you'll realize that Indians speak a combination of English and Hindi, and we call it Hinglish, right? It's a very hard nuance to train a model, and it took Alexa years. It was like the longest training process that they went through. But in Amazon, we always had some level of human Q&A, some moderation always, no matter what we were, even if it was not as complex as your use case, there was always human intervention there. So you using some people behind the scenes to help translate what the user is saying, that is what you could, that translation data is what you could use to train your model. And you will still need to invest in some moderation, some Q&A, so that you start getting more accurate responses before you completely automate, right? So you're building a journey for yourself here, saying this is where I start, and eventually I'll be able to train this model to a point and I don't need the human resourcing, right? But maybe when you start off, you start with something which is more heavily dependent on humans. It's a bit more manual, doesn't feel automated or AI, but how do you train a model when you don't have that translation that you're talking about, right? So it's very cool to start with, a slower process, a more manual process, and eventually it's more important to get it right rather than get it automated, is what I would say. Does that make sense?
It does. Thank you for your wisdom there. Thank you.
Of course.
Cool. Jose also has a question. Are you familiar with the US DARPA program from 2012 called Gallo? You also shared a Wikipedia link.
Actually, I'm not. I'm going to look it up. Thank you for sharing.
Cool. Gallo stands for cognitive assistants that learn and organize. And just so that you have just some snippet, it was the basis of Siri in the United States. If you know about Stanford Research Institute,
you will
understand this real quickly. The government, after they created this Gallo agent, they wanted to sell the technology. They went to Stanford Research Institute, and Steve Jobs at Apple was alive at the time, went over to Menlo Park, where Stanford Research Institute exists, and he put an I in SRI and created Siri.
I see.
So if you want to know the history of Siri, you have to look at this DARPA project called Gallo. And anyway,
thank you. That's great. That's very interesting. I'm going to look it up. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Jose, for sharing that. Okay, we are at time, but I think, Rupa, do you have time for like 2-3 minutes?
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. So we have a question from Yogesh. He's asking, can you also highlight some risk that you foresee with the rise of Gen AI? And any advice for businesses who are trying to jump into this?
Yeah, I think we covered a couple of topics here, and happy to understand your specific use case as well. But in general, again, it depends on the data you're using for training. I gave you the example of the artist, right? And if you read, if you've read the recent news about OpenAI trying to build some partnerships with different media companies where they're sourcing news to train their data, right? So anyone who has their content, their information, their data being used would expect some protection or compensation, one of the two, right? So how do you preempt that upfront? and think through ways of not putting yourself at legal risk. That would be one thing to think about. Two is, again, going back to user considerations. Is the data you're using to build your product comprehensive, accurate, inclusive? Some of those aspects are important. You will unintentionally exclude a lot of user base because you didn't think through some of these risks that are involved in just going out on the internet and picking up whatever's out there. So thinking about what data that needs to be used to train your models to give the user a respectful, inclusive, and a delightful experience is the starting point. And if you don't have that, where would you source that? Do you need to build partnerships? Do you need to buy that data? What thinking about? And also, the questions that were brought earlier about people using your products or using Gen AI for negative reasons. I think those are inherent risks that come with the society we live in. And can you mitigate any of those with the products you are launching is worth thinking about. Those are some top of mind, but if I can learn more about your specific use case, I can give you some more specific inputs as well.
Great, Rupa. So just quick thing. So what we're seeing is there are a lot of enterprises who are a little more traditional in nature, right? And where the data is the biggest problem, which you said you started by your entire presentation by saying data is the core of wherever, whatever we want to build, right? Whether it's a Gen AI or conversational AI. So we're talking with a lot of, let's say, conventional companies where data is not their structure, right? Which is always a problem that they have certain formats now. The expectation is that Gen AI will be able to scrape through your tables, through your large data sets, the images, et cetera, et cetera. But the structure is not there. And sometimes we feel that though the expectation is certain, but the data is very unstructured. So we find these kind of organizations struggle a lot in terms of, kind of getting up to speed, getting full value out of these solutions. So that is where I was coming from. Where would be that starting point for such companies who are just, let's say, very traditional in nature, have data in a different, not that structured data, but they want to kind of leverage such kind of technologies.
This is a real problem, and I don't think I have seen a lot of great approaches yet. And I recently posted something about how this is going to get a lot more worse and complex. Mm-hmm. Is because AI capabilities, when they expand to visual content, video content, when we create tables and enterprise level data, it's still comparatively, it's still structured compared to what people do with videos and photos. They just click, click, they shoot, right? And so it becomes a lot more harder to process that. So again, I think these are real challenges. Making sure that you have addressed this concern even before you go down the path of, building that product. If you don't have the ability to turn that unstructured data into something that's going to add value to your users, hold on till you figure that out. Hold on till technology gets to a point where you can just pull in. And again, your use case might be very specific. Make sure that you're not jumping into this. The other piece of advice I'll give is a lot of us, myself included, we're all kind of getting caught into Gen AI, conversational AI, co-pilots. There's a lot of terminology.
Yeah.
I would say don't get caught into that. And again, go back to your user, obsess with the problem you're solving.
Yeah.
It will make it very easy for you to choose the path you want to go with, right? When we start with, I want to do something in Gen AI versus conversational, or maybe I'll combine both. We are obsessing with the technology and not thinking about why are we even doing this in the first place. And I've seen this, I've been working in this space for 12 years now. And I always see people get excited about, I want to do something in Gen AI. Just that's generally how they start a project. And then you run into, okay, so I don't have the data for it. Or I don't know how to convert this unstructured data into something meaningful for my use case. And you're if you start the project already, you're going to make a very expensive investment, which you can't walk back from. So I would advise start from the problem that you're solving.
Sure. Thanks, Rupa. That's really helpful. Thanks a lot.
Of course.
Great. If people have any last questions for Rupa, we're here to take it one last time. And in the meantime, I'm sharing in Rupa's LinkedIn, her website, her ebook on getting started with conversational AI, her newsletter on LinkedIn, and also a course on Reforge. Please do check them out, pin them, save them. Okay, I think we are good at time.
Thank you so much, Manu, for having me, and thank you, everyone. So much. Yeah, if you have follow-up questions, please reach out to me on LinkedIn. I can see folks still asking questions. If I missed anything that you wanted to learn about, do not hesitate. I'm happy to respond offline as well. Thank you again for your time. It was a pleasure meeting all of you.
Thank you so much, Rupa. Thank you for taking your time.
Have a good one.
Everyone. Bye.